Okay, so for the next session, we have fireside chat with Vani Kola and Karan Bhagat. Will trigger our minds on how to learn to unlearn. There's a lot of stuff where we need to go back to basics, and this is a great time to sort of reflect on that. And this is the conversation that Vani and Karan will be having. Vani Kola is Managing Director of Kalari Capital and has been identified as one of the most powerful men in business by Fortune. And the session will be moderated by Mr. Karan Bhagat, who is the Managing Director and CEO of IIFL Wealth and Asset Management.
Good evening, Vani. Great to meet you again, virtually this time, in a very, very different environment. But it's always a pleasure interacting with you. And, you know, born in Hyderabad, starting two companies, Certus Software and Rightworks. You know, did technology investing come naturally to you?
I don't think so, Karan, because I never saw myself as an investor. I saw myself as an entrepreneur and a founder, and I still think of myself that way, though I have always been like tech geek from a young age. But I think it was really the entrepreneurial opportunity of moving to India and being and doing something on the ground, you know, and being early to it. Which I think was what was interesting to me. So I think of myself more as an entrepreneur, less as an investor.
Interesting. But tell me something, you know, is in some ways, you know, especially given technology, do you think the current pandemic in some very cryptic way accelerated the adoption of digitization in most of the businesses?
Yeah, I think it's been a boon, if one may say so, in the most perverse way, so to speak. But I think the digital adoption was forwarded by a decade, if not more, because of the pandemic. And what's good about that, at least from my perspective, is it allows for more of equitability and inclusiveness to really happen across, you know, across geographies, across everywhere. So I definitely think that as far as digitization goes, this lockdown and pandemic has been a huge boost.
Interesting. But, you know, if I was to kind of look at different businesses, and you've kind of got exposed both in your avatar as an entrepreneur, as well as, you know, being into investing for the longest time possible, you've kind of got exposed to multiple sectors, multiple demographics, potentially, you know, multiple business models. You know, given where we are today, and the pandemic obviously has in some perverse way helped us certain businesses, going forward from here, you know, if you were to identify two or three sectors, you know, which ones do you think would have the maximum potential, both from a business perspective as well as, you know, a little bit of social impact in terms of job creation and so on and so forth? Where do you think is the sweet spot, you know, for a new entrepreneur today?
Well, there are different questions in there. Where is the sweet spot is a different question probably for an entrepreneur versus where is their large scale impact from job creation and social impact. Two underserved areas, education and health, I think definitely benefit from the technology enablement and acceleration of consumer behavior to accept a different sort of models of interfacing and interacting. So I think both these sectors, one can probably serve a wider audience, truly achieve sort of the constitutional purpose of access and inclusiveness to every citizen, if you will. So I think these are definitely sectors that will continue to see transformative impact. And in terms of what are the areas, I think we have to take a little broader global perspective. I think if we take a global perspective, if anything, startups have become a bit more democratized in terms of where they can be located, right? And that, I think, can play to India's strength. So we are already seeing that there is a wave of global SaaS companies emerging out of India. So hopefully we can create that as a powerhouse and hub out of India. And in terms of job creation, hopefully we can get, you know, we saw the news from Apple and Foxconn, and we know as far as wide-ranged job creation goes, it can't simply be the knowledge economy, but also the manufacturing economy that has to grow in order to be able to do that. So hopefully the global kind of shifts that are going on right now will also favor India as a destination with some help from government and regulation. to really create better employment across regions?
So that gets me to an interesting question then, you know, with so much of, in a sense, globalization possible pretty much at the snap of a finger, how do business models and platforms create loyalty, right? Because loyalty is extremely, extremely critical. And, you know, even if you were to look at things like programs on Netflix or, you know, Hotstar and so on and so forth, we are loyal, but we are pretty much driven by what's exciting this week. And so how do we really play as tech entrepreneurs to kind of retain loyalty of our customers?
I mean, loyalty is never an entitlement. And maybe at some point we thought it was. And loyalty is earned every day. And it's good from a consumer perspective. If you have the best content, they'll come to you. If Sony creates a scam, then they'll go watch it on, you know, Sony, right? So I think from a competitiveness, loyalty comes from being able to offer service. You know, you and I are not going to go to a hotel that didn't serve you right just out of loyalty, you know. So I think that's true of everything. Maybe before we lacked choice and hence you thought the customer was loyal. So there's a big difference between loyalty and lack of choice, right? So loyalty has to be defined by or earned by continuing to be best at what you do. And if you do, your customer will reward you. And if you don't, they won't, right? I mean, if Amazon misses delivering to me 5 times in a row or even 2 times in a row, I might just order from Jio. So loyalty has to do with continuously being on that edge of product and service quality and innovation.
That's interesting. That's a new one. I really like it. Loyalty is a service. Now, coming to your your career as an investor, I think we heard of Kalari as well as you, very, very early in our lives. And you were investing in e-commerce when most of us kind of didn't even imagine or understand this space. Love to understand 3 aspects within that. One, you know, what kind of got you attracted to the space fairly early? Second, obviously, it's kind of played out beautifully in multiple investments you've done. What do you think was the, you know, couple of points which kind of resulted in that delta moment for the investment thesis to play out? And given where we are today, do you think there's still a long rope to go? I think these would be the 3 bigger points within e-commerce I would love to kind of cover.
See, Karan, e-commerce or otherwise, I think there is a problem when we have too much knowledge because it makes us skeptic to new ideas. So for all of us every day, it's about shedding what we know and learning and being open to what we don't know, right? And if I worry about anything, it is every day, am I being open to learning or because I think I know something, does that create a blind spot for me? So I think in specific to e-commerce, I think it helped that I had an outside perspective, that I came to India without sort of the burden of what hasn't worked, right? So the promise of convenience to the customer, we had just talked about loyalty and service, and the inclusiveness of the customer experience, no matter where they are and who they are, I felt that the time had come for this in India, okay? And the consumer was demanding that, maybe in a dormant way, but that the consumer was ready for it. Now, could we do it, as in could we offer this despite lack of logistics infrastructure and online payment and lack of regulatory clarity? These were the 3 things that, you know, we grappled with when we thought about this sector. And we realized that we can create India-centered solutions. It doesn't have to be the UPS or for Amazon or the model for Alibaba, but we could create India-centered solutions to solve the problem of logistics and payment. Okay, now how long it takes, that can be anybody's guess, but these are solvable problems, even though we didn't inherit those infrastructures already, right? But regulatory was a big question. And I have a view that if you truly serve the customer and, you know, and the customer needs you and wants you, and a company has the staying power, then you can work with the government to evolve the regulation, you know, like mobile payments. You know, we made some early investments in mobile payments that didn't work out because it took a decade later. But look, I mean, we have 3 billion plus UPI payments happening, you know, every month and so on and so forth, right? So I think regulation will work if you really have consumer staying power, you know. e-commerce, of course, is here and is more and more mainstream already. I see that from anecdotally, the number of zip codes, you know, who's ordering, you know, the penetration into tier 2, tier 3 cities. Now we have a local player, Jio, right? And so there is, the platform is probably done. I think there is enough that's done in the platform, and we were early to it. Fortunately, we made some money on that. But I do think there's plenty of room for building DTC brands. I think India is still an underserved brand country, and offering really unique experiences, you know, hyper-local, global, using content and community influence. There are many of these trends which will drive new startups. So while the time and window to create a aggregated platform is probably done, there is a great opportunity to build unique brands.
Got it. And you know, just in the last 6 months, in spite of everything around us, we saw some large investments coming into the e-commerce space. Obviously, one can't ignore the giant investment by Facebook and many others into Reliance Jio. And, you know, we also saw a lot of new investments coming, especially on the education and the health side. You know, Byju's was a classic example. And then Byju's acquisition of,
White Hat
Junior and so on and so forth. Do you really see some of these valuations, which to some of us old timers who kind of look at earnings per share and P multiples historically and typically factor in a 15-20% growth, you know, do you see the rope long enough for some of these bases to get adjusted? Because obviously, as futuristic thinkers, if the growth comes through, then all of these numbers will follow.
Well, then, I mean, look, like what happened with WeWork, right? It's a cycle of this business. Some, of course, I remember when Google went public at 10 billion, okay, which was at that time like a big number, right? And massive earnings multiple. And people questioned where it would go next, and look at it today, right? So if one can continue to innovate and continue to expand the platforms, then I think, and that's what perhaps the bet is on these valuations. Now, how right, how wrong they are, some of it will be right, some of it will be wrong. I mean, there's no, you know, straight line story to these investments. We have seen enough things go wrong, but it happens where you make these massive bets because there are enough examples of where it has gone right, right? And have created, you know, sort of massive defining companies, if you will, whether it's Facebook, Google, and others. Of course, Microsoft is an old company, but, you know, many other recent past that have, you know, unbelievable $2 trillion value market cap, right? So, and we are far from creating any such companies yet in India. And so I think that it's a different game, as you know, that we are early stage investors and we play to certain loss ratio. Right. And I assume that when you are at that level of a growth investor, you are still playing to certain loss ratio. And but what investment in Jio and Byju's and others that you mentioned has done is, you know, it has put renewed focus on Indian startup ecosystem. And I think that's a good thing because this kind of capital inflow for India in 2006, when I moved to India, would have been completely unthinkable. I'm sure that there is a bubble. There's always a bubble. And you call it a bubble when something fails, but you don't know which one that is. But if we look at the underlying market opportunity in India, especially from technology disruption and innovation and the catch up of that and the potential of that, that's really where the excitement is, at least for me.
Got it. Makes a lot of sense. Now, you know, you made a few points about a few of the things which we implement kind of going wrong. And when I look at some of these companies, which we all invest in, two or three kind of characteristics kind of come out, and would love to kind of get your views on it. One, I think, you know, I run a company where I've got one large private equity, you know, two large private equity investors. And, you know, we learned through how to kind of manage all different set of views in the boardroom, kind of temper everybody's expectations, and yet kind of tread down the right path. Now, a lot of the investments you've done see a lot of different sets of firms coming in. And how difficult is it to kind of manage sometimes even the entrepreneur who can be relatively younger, together with a club of, but together with a set of different private equity investors with different exit timelines and objectives. How have you been really been able to kind of congruate all of these different conflicts of interest and make good headway in some of these investments?
I don't know if there's a conflict of interest, but what there is a maybe structural dissonance. Let me see if I can articulate it simply. Most early stage investors come from a very founder-centric empathy and know that the founders are not really ready for complex boardroom discussions and disagreements. So those board meetings are much more advisory meetings. But ultimately, the purpose of a board is to question, challenge, and protect the interests of the larger shareholders. That's why, you know, there is a board. And there will be diversity of viewpoints. The management team's ability to work through that, you know, sometimes is very shortened, right? So because very, very quickly, there are different kind of investors joining in, and the ability of the entrepreneurs to have learned their way through and managing these complex board dynamics is could be what causes struggle. Usually it helps if there is a alignment or a clear leader in the board who can kind of liaison those things in the growth of the company. And sometimes that doesn't exist. There isn't a clear liaison that all parties will sort of conduct around and trust. And when that breaks down, there is really even, it's unfortunate, but even for good companies with good ideas, good market, we see tremendous value erosion happen, and that's painful. And, you know, for me as a board member, when that happens, as painful as it is, the only option when you can no longer align with the board is to get off the board. And fortunately, while it has happened rarely. And most of the time, we are able to work with the founders and the rest of the board to, you know, help find that equilibrium and balance. But one thing that would help is, you know, there is work that investors need to do because they have the knowledge and the leverage, but there's also work founders need to do in building deeper relationships and investing personal time to get to know various board members, their style of operation, their trigger points, and figure out how to work effectively with each of them. This can pay rich dividends, and in fact, it is necessary, you know, and transition from the early stage where there is a notion that the board exists to serve me to a notion that the board is my boss, you know, and so that's a transition that you need to go through. And I think sometimes it's hard for some companies, and more education all of us can do around it, more handholding will serve the ecosystem better.
Great. That sounds really nice. So I just some valuable lessons for all of us there. I think one question kind of it raises in my mind as I hear you here. I think everything at all points of time can't go right. And even the best make mistakes. So what's your view on failure, and where do you really stand on that? And, you know, I'm sure you've seen in fair degree of investments, a lot of people whom you initially thought held a lot of promise potentially were kind of leaders who had the ability to execute beautifully, but still ended up on the wrong side of the line. So what do you think of failure, and what can we learn from it?
I mean, one thing is really most successful people have had setbacks in their life at some point or the other, okay? As in life and in business, you do get other chances to succeed. It's never sort of a singular point, rarely it is. So, you know, the ability to self-reflect and, you know, ability to sort of come back and not expect straight line to success and just that mindset, right? You know, the truth is setbacks are a part of your journey or will be a part of your journey. And the skills around ability to take advice, ability to self-believe, and craft solutions to come back. And, you know, that's what separates the idea and even the execution versus the person, right? And that's why you find that some entrepreneurs, given the same set of circumstances, can somehow pivot and make something happen and others not. So, you know, it's all of this though is theoretical book reading on how to handle failure. And it's not of much help until you can create personal frameworks to prepare for the unanticipated moment of setback and how you handle that. And it can come from many things, but fundamentally, I believe it's important to have broad-based mentors and broad-based interests in life to balance out the disappointments and failures, to find a larger purpose and perspective to our existence and potential, because ultimately that's what helps you to overcome and find the answers. And if you believe answers exist, then you're going to work towards finding that. Ultimately, it's that that separates, you know, some founders who really can inspire by the turnaround of what they were able to make happen.
So, you know, in the kind of startup world which you've been investing in, there is a continuous kind of fundraise event happening in the life of an entrepreneur. And, you know, if I was to think back in my own life over the last, 13 to 14 years, I've had to do it twice. And it's kind of consumed a lot of energy, bandwidth. You know, it kind of retests all our assumptions about our own business models. And, you know, as a startup entrepreneur, a phenomenal number of them are successful. They need to kind of continuously be on that journey. What's your advice to an entrepreneur? How does he balance the objective of growth, raising capital, and yet kind of pivoting, as you said rightly, on the business model?
I'll tell a personal story, Karan. I always thought of myself as a founder that was product-oriented, though, of course, I was the founder CEO. And the HR issues always bogged me down. So, and I would always sort of like complain to say, oh, you know, I was a founder to create a great product, not to deal with all this stuff. And then, you know, one of my VPs challenged me to say, then why are you the CEO, right? Why don't you be the CTO? And it made me think to say, you know, if I want to be the CEO, then I have to not keep complaining about the job that I have to do. And if I only want to work on the product, then I should, yeah, let somebody else be the CEO and I should focus on the product only, right? So my point here is, as an entrepreneur, this notion of, oh, I'm wasting so much time on fundraising. I mean, get on with it. Financial solvency is your first priority. And if you don't want to do that, then you have to have somebody else who does that job, and because somebody has to do that job. Whether that's getting customers to pay or finding investors to underwrite your vision, you have to make time for it. And this notion, I don't have time for it, I mean, I don't have a lot of sympathy for it. On running the business, if you feel fundraising is holding you back from doing that, then build a team that doesn't need you to be part of solving every problem. Let them handle the day-to-day challenges and you focus on strategy, funding, customers, hiring, and more importantly, providing the moral compass of the company. And in each of these, what do you enjoy doing? What are your strengths? And whatever is not your strength and you don't enjoy, then you find the right people who can do that. But, you know, you have to be always on the treadmill of raising funds, meaning it's not that you have to be closing funding every 6 months, but you have to be building the roadmap for the company at all times.
Got it. I think that's a very straight and a very honest answer. And hopefully all of us as entrepreneurs kind of are able to balance that effectively. So one last question from my side, and then I'll potentially put forward two questions from our friends who are listening into us. So what advice would you have for entrepreneurs who've still not kind of necessarily integrated technology into their businesses? And let's say at the back of the mind, they're saying, you know, servicing my client extremely well, and he's loyal to me. Where do I stand to lose?
I mean, you stand to lose before you can blink, and when you don't know it. So my only simple answer is, I mean, what are you waiting for? Do it now, you know, and get the right support through whatever mechanism, consulting, somebody in-house. But technology is going to be integral to all our lives, and how you use that to further your business is going to be important. The Kirana guy is doing that today. You know, he understands that if this can be effective for my business, if I can do Google Pay and my customer can just tell me and I can take an order online and deliver it, gosh, he's using technology. So we don't have to call it technology. How do your customers want to interact with you? How do you make that more effective? How do you make your own organization more productive? And technology is simply a means. It doesn't have to be the boogeyman, you know, and just get on with it.
So two questions from my friends. One question from Nitesh is basically asking, what would you value more as an investor, size or profitability?
Size and unit economics, I would say. Not profitability, but there's a big difference. Okay. So the core unit economics have to work at any level. Size simply means that for you're capturing market and you may not be profitable because you're in an aggressive market capture mode. But the one thing even from early on that we emphasize a lot is getting comfortable on the core clarity of unit economics of this business.
Got it. Second question is from a gentleman called Nitin. He says, Amazon, Flipkart, Big Basket, Grofers, all incurring large losses, but valuations keep going up. Number one, his question is, do you think these companies will ever make profits? Or is it just about escalating valuations and potentially making exits later?
Well, Amazon is one of the smartest companies on earth, so you need to take them off that list. And I think it's a more complex question about Amazon. On the other companies, you know, I think that whether it's Big Basket, Grofers, they are early to market. And I believe that either they will become profitable and independent, or much like Flipkart, Walmart, there is a very strategic value to somebody, you know, and that is what will give value to the investors and customers in return. So when you're an early mover to a market, there are, and you can get to sizable scale, there are some advantages that I think you get from leverage that you can achieve from time to market that others that are behind have to pay the price for it, right? So, you know, that's what I would say.
Great. And last question, Vani, and, you know, both professionally as well as personally, any great lessons from the pandemic for the last 6 to 7 months, which kind of will stay with you and, you know, will cause you to reflect as you continue to kind of flourish on your investing career?
So I'll separate those two, professional and personal, though they, of course, bleed together in many things. I think, you know, whenever we are faced with a situation of significant gravity, I think we all are subjected to wishful thinking, and we defer to make timely, decisive decisions. It's natural and human, but I think it's exactly what we need to watch out for, to be pragmatic, realistic in making these decisions that are inevitable, even if unpleasant, and to face it head on, because I think we have a better chance of emerging stronger, better than burying our head in sand, right? And like I said, all of us have to smaller or greater tendency to do that. And the pandemic, if anything, reinforced that over and over and over again. Personally, I think a lot more thought around social isolation at various levels and what does that mean and how do we as a race live and thrive off of each other, and watching like young people in my children's age be isolated, or old people like my parents' age be isolated, and what that means coming home, just reinforcing how much the world needs to be, how much we need to each watch out for each other and support each other from empathy and tolerance. And the pandemic reinforces fragile fabric of relationships and what ultimately really matters in life for all of us.
Thank you, Vani. That was excellent. It was great interaction. And thank you, Ascent, and everybody for listening to us. And Vani, any final remarks? Thanks a lot.
I mean, good to chat with you. I want the final remarks from you, because we didn't sort of hear, you know, your vast knowledge of wisdom. So what's your sort of takeaway from the pandemic? And we can close with that.
No, I think professionally, I'm not a big fan from work from home. Obviously, work goes on. Productivity has been 100%. But personally, I feel a little bit of the innovation on Zoom is not as effective as when we are together as a team. And secondly, I think, the social X factor always pushes us to give that 10% extra. So personally, I'm in a camp. I'm hoping that at least 50 to 60% of the office gets back quickly. But otherwise, work continues, productivity is very high, and that kind of keeps me very buoyant. But otherwise, I think, I'm listening to you for the last half an hour. I must sign off by saying I'm fairly motivated to accelerate the pace of digitization in our own firm. I won't call ourselves absolutely far away from technology, but potentially we should invest more time into that, and hopefully we can increase our and better our client consumer experience. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Karan. Good to chat with you. Appreciate you doing this.
Thank you.